cool. So I'm going to tell you a little bit about myself and a little bit about my work. And then just kind of share some tips and tricks along the way since I started. And so I just want to thank you guys for finding me and introducing me to Skylar, and I'm really excited to be here. I feel very jealous that you guys get to get your master's in social innovation, which is awesome.
I think you're the first speaker to admit some jealousy.
We know that they've all been jealous.
I'll admit it. I walked in and I was like, oh, this is where I want to be. You know, like, so you guys just hanging out.
I know.
It looks like that, doesn't it?
You can think and learn. And it's cool. So, I mean, I would just have to say is that so everything in New York is an amazing place. Take advantage of every single opportunity. I was born and raised here, and so I like to say welcome to my city, and I just, you know, this is a place that you can truly make yourself, make or break yourself. Cool. So I'll just tell you a little bit about myself. I'm Haitian American. My family's from Haiti. And they emigrated here in like the early 70s. I was born in the mid 70s. And so the furthest thing that that you would ever see is a Haitian guy snowboarding on a mountain. Or a Haitian American. And so I love this picture because this picture was me. I got invited to participate in this sort of gathering. It was called a gathering of artists and technologists. That was like at the summit of this hike, and I got to like go backcountry like hiking and then ride back. So I like right after I took that picture, I had to like ride down the pretty steep mountain, and I was with like Olympians and professional snowboarders and like tech people and social innovators, and I loved that picture because it was really, really hard. That smile is a fake smile because I was definitely a fish out of the water, and it kind of epitomizes to me entrepreneurship, that you have to do things that make you feel uncomfortable. Mm-hmm. You have to do things that pull you out of your comfort zone. And I was the last one up that hill. I was the last one into the lodge. But when I got into the lodge, everybody was all dressed and with their hot cocoa, and I was the last one in, and everybody started giving me a high five and like clapping me, and they did a standing ovation because they knew that I had did something that I'd never done before. And so that's kind of like my call to you, is to always rise to the occasion and challenge yourself to don't do the easy thing. And that's kind of characterized me. I'm also a father and a husband. That's another source of pride. Through this journey of starting my organization, I never, ever, ever thought that I would be standing in front of, you know, a room full of master's level students talking about just my work. And so, I get a lot from it. The other thing is, you know, I'm a snowboarder, but I'm, you know, this new thing called a social entrepreneur. I was just an entrepreneur. I know that this is my second business technically, but I learned that nonprofit is just like a for-profit. You just have to bring in more money than you spend. That's what it is. And so I'll delve into that a little bit before I sort of talk about like my work and the problems that I'm solving. Mm-hmm. But when I was in college, I sort of aspired to, you know, be a, you know, business marketing executive, and I, you know, found my way into that sort of line of work, and a few sort of years into it, I realized that, like, oh my God, I am a taker of society. I'm a recipient of things. I never give back. And it just kind of hit me with a ton of bricks one day. I was like, oh my gosh, I better start giving back before I don't have anything to give, you know? And that sort of question, that curiosity sort of led me to, you know, asking questions and seeking things and doing things that made me feel uncomfortable. You know, whether it was, you know, I don't want to repeat things that you know, that you could watch in videos, but like be able to walk up to a person and ask them a question, to be able to like be able to convene a group and force yourself to be a leader. Like I had to force myself to be an outgoing, talkative person. And oftentimes when you're dealing with big problems in the world, right, and if you think that you have the solution to it, the thing that brought you to where you are today is not going to get you to where you need to be in order to fix that problem. Does that make sense? Right? And so you as a social innovator have to constantly evolve.
Mm-hmm.
You have to constantly grow.
Mm-hmm.
And there's a lot of self-reflection that comes
mm-hmm.
as part of it. There's a lot of, you know, who am I? You know, I remember talking to people and people would say, you know, my family did, and like one of my favorite stories is like, you know, what do you do if, you know, five people tell you no to your idea, right? What if 10 people tell you no? What if 50 people tell you no, right? What if 150 people told you no? And your mom and your dad tell you no. Your sister, your brother, your uncle, right? And oftentimes it's a very lonely experience being like, somebody that has an idea that you want to share into the world. And I'm considering that if you're paying good money to be here, you don't want to do normal shit. Sorry. Like, you don't want to do just run-of-the-mill stuff. You didn't come here to just get a job. You came here to like make a really big dent into the world, right?
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
Like, you don't want to just, you know, be basic, right? Like, we're not basic people. And so that's kind of what I'm going to challenge you to think about, challenge you to be, and challenge you to, you know, to sort of cast your vision into the world. And so, you know, along the path to me starting my organization, you know, the quick down and dirty story is, one day I found myself laying on the floor in my own living room. And I haven't really told this story, so this is pretty cool, right? So I was laying on the floor of my living room. My girlfriend was in the bedroom. We were in the process of breaking up. And I knew that my relationship of 7 years was about to end. And part of me was really sad. I was like, oh my God, my life is going to change. We all know, we've all been through this, right? Whether it's leaving family, leaving a relationship, whatever. And for a brief moment, I asked myself, if there's anything that I could do in the world right now, what would I do? And the first thing that came to my mind was, I should go snowboard. It was weird because in my living room, I was looking at my snowboard, who I hadn't touched in over a year, and I was like, oh my God, I have a little bit of money. I can actually go snowboarding. And it went from, any challenge goes from being an obstacle to being it becomes an opportunity. And oftentimes, if you are used to taking risks and taking chances, like, all you have to do is just keep asking yourself, if I can do anything in the world right now, what would I do? And so that sort of personal journey of snowboarding really opened me up, right? Like, I was able to sort of think big dreams and stand on top of mountains and sort of think and be. You know what I'm talking about, right? Like, and that happens when you're traveling, right?
Mm-hmm.
Like, when you're on a plane, you're on a train, when you're walking through the city, and maybe your family, thousands of miles away, right? And when you're walking in the city and you're looking at all the tall buildings and you're by yourself, maybe you're listening to your song, mm-hmm. right? That little glimpse of moment, that's like being completely present.
Mm-hmm.
And that to me is the opportunity. Yes, the opportunity to sort of inject something beautiful.
Mm-hmm.
And so it was during that time of snowboarding, and I was also mentoring at the same time, where I really thought of, like, wouldn't it be great, you know, if I can sort of marry my two passions. Like, I really love working with kids, and I really love snowboarding, right? It was really that simple. And I'm gonna tell you exactly how I did it. And so, and it was the last run of my last day and I was in Whistler, standing on top of the mountain, and I was like, wouldn't it be great if I had the kid that I was mentoring here with me, and we were looking at these mountains together, and I knew that would transform his life, but it would really help me connect to him on a different level.
Mm-hmm.
What I ended up learning was that there's this thing called the opportunity gap. And the opportunity gap is the difference in life trajectory between a low-income, poor, disadvantaged person and a person of means, right? We all know this. I would say that if you're sitting here in this room with me, listening to me, and you're able to take classes, you can count off on your hands 10 people, 5 people that don't even understand what you're going through, right? They don't even understand what an opportunity that you have right now. So they're kind of stuck in this opportunity, right? And so this quest really sort of, you know, when I started to delve into what the opportunity gap was, it led me to a whole new sort of level of thinking, and I became obsessed about this opportunity gap. And it's global. You know, you Google, it's like what's happening in the Middle East with youth unemployment, right? That's part of the global opportunity gap. There's the skills gap. There's like all of these things, and it's all trapped up into this one nugget of an idea. And it comes down to education, it comes down to experiences and relationships, right? And oftentimes, those, you know, you go to school, but it's not really about what you learn, right? It's about it's about what you learn in between the classes, right? It's about hustling to register for that class or to get the bill paid or to like convince Skylar that you need an extra day for a paper or something, right? It's all of those little things that add up to your education, right? A lot of people don't know this. A lot of people never get the chance to experience that. That's really important, right? To be able to navigate structures, that's an opportunity, right? Experiences, getting on a plane, mixing with different cultures, speaking different languages, eating different foods, all of those things add up. We are living in New York. What an experience. Question, who's had some crazy shit happen to them since they've been in New York?
Oh my God.
Yeah, of course. And it's beautiful, right? Because what happens? You have a story to tell.
Mm-hmm.
We have multiple stories to tell. And that's what makes up who we are as people. Like, it's our sum. We are the sum of our experiences. And I'd venture to say, and I dare you to get more experience. I dare you to push yourself more, like, do something you've never, like, I know this is on camera, but, like, I just met this woman, and she's starting an organization, and I was reading a lot, and she's like, oh, I go and visit kids at Rikers. I was like, oh, I'm going to go to Rikers. Like, I know it's a crazy thing, nobody ever wants to go to jail, but, like, there's just something, you know what I mean, to put yourself in a different environment. To understand, because I think as social innovators, you need to understand differently. Like, it's almost like you're anthropologists, right? Like, you just need to understand people and where they are in the world. And I think just being a student of the world is going to make you much better at what you do. And then the last part is relationships. So like, you know, anybody heard the expression, it's not what you know, it's
yeah.
Exactly, right? And so oftentimes, you know, it's those people that you meet one time, right? So like, I met these guys,
mm-hmm.
and then they introduced me to you.
Mm-hmm.
Like,
mm-hmm.
it was a relationship.
Mm-hmm.
How I actually got to speak at the Creative Mornings was that I met Tina Swissmiss,
mm-hmm.
right?
Yeah.
I used to work on the ninth floor in a building. She worked on the sixth floor in a building, right?
Mm-hmm.
We never met.
Mm-hmm.
We had to meet at a conference in Northern California.
Mm-hmm.
Right? Which is crazy. How I got there was the person that referred me to that conference, her husband was my employee. You know what I mean? Like, it was just like all these crazy connections, and it's all about relationships. So like, and it was relationships that actually casted me into this nonprofit sort of social entrepreneurship world. It's like I just knew that the more people you knew, the more you can get your ideas out there. The more ideas you get out there, the more feedback you get. The more feedback you get, the more support you get. And it's actually kind of, it's a little bit of formula. I think it's essentially called social capital, right?
Mm-hmm.
And social capital is, like, I would venture to say, the number one currency in the world right now.
Mm-hmm.
And it's about building a network, right? Oh, very nerdy thing. Very nerdy thing. I, through this whole path of learning about the opportunity gap, I would just keep asking myself questions. And oftentimes too, you can do, it's very simple. You just open up a thing, you just start asking yourself questions. I just have questions about the question. And so one of the questions that I asked about like how to solve the opportunity gap was, I wonder if there's any correlation between GDP and social capital. It's a very odd, very random connection.
Mm-hmm.
And I just so happened to found this PhD paper, right, online, that studied the link between GDP in Europe and social capital. So question, you guys are very smart. I know you guys are smart, right? What country do you think has the highest GDP and social capital in Europe?
Germany.
Denmark.
That's what everybody said. Who said that?
Denmark.
Mm-hmm. Close. Who said that?
Norway.
It's Norway. Perfect. What country do you think has the lowest? It's not France. Everybody else says France.
Greece?
Greece. It's Greece. And that makes sense, right? And they link social capital to civic engagement, trust. Trust is the number one indicator of social capital. And I wanted to play with you this thing. So part of the thing that sort of led me to, you know, learning about the opportunity gap, and then the best part about solving a problem is that, and especially the more you dive into this problem and build these networks and create these experiences, that there are very smart, there's much smarter people than you actually working on the same problem. And so I found this problem that linked part of the experience and the social and the skills, and it was called the 6,000-hour learning gap. And so when I found this, I was like, my jaw dropped. Like, this is when you talk about inclusion and being able to like create opportunities. So here's.
If you're a child who lives in a middle-class American family, chances are you didn't start learning the day you began kindergarten. And you don't stop learning when the school day ends or summer begins. Your parents have likely been reading to you since you could hold Goodnight Moon in your baby hands. You might have seen your first pumpkin patch or your first nature trail or the seals at the aquarium from the seat of your stroller. Chances are you spent time in a good preschool, and now you dance or program robots after school and during summers. By the time kids reach sixth grade, middle-class kids have likely spent 6,000 more hours learning than kids who were born into poverty. Sounds like a big gap, doesn't it? So let's check our math against what the research says. 220. That's how many more hours well-off parents are likely to have spent reading to their children. 1,395 hours. That's the difference between having and not having a preschool education, which poor children access at significantly lower levels. 3,060 hours. Poor children lose even more ground in grade school. They're significantly less likely to be enrolled in enriching after-school programs or extracurriculars. 1,080 hours. Well-off kids are 8 times more likely to enjoy camp or another summer learning opportunity than poor kids. 245 hours. That's how much less time poor kids have likely spent visiting zoos, museums, or similar institutions during summer breaks. Altogether, that adds up to a 6,000-hour gap in learning time between kids who live in poverty and well-off children on the day they arrive at middle school.
The crazy thing about this is that, like, when sometimes, like, if you're going to pick something like water or education to solve, right? Like, if you're going to pick something really hard like me, like, closing the opportunity gap, you're gonna latch onto any piece of nugget of information in order to prove your case. Because oftentimes you need to get funded and you need to build a community around the problem that you're solving. And so when I saw this, I was like, oh my God, this is something that I can hold on to. And then at the same time, David Brooks, a writer for the New York Times, do anybody know him, right?
Yeah.
David Brooks, he wrote an article about a year before this, and he talked about the opportunity. It was actually called The Opportunity Gap. And that was something that really just kind of set it off for me. That was like the trigger in my mind. That was like my disease. That was the disease that I was looking to cure. That was like, and especially if you have like a major paper like New York Times talking about it. And now, you know, the president and everybody's talking about this upcoming election's all about the opportunity gap. It's also, you know, wrapped up in income inequality, right? And these are the things. So like the opportunity gap that I'm specifically focusing on is about young people. It's like, how do we intervene at a young level in order to sort of change their life trajectory? And so the other interesting thing is, while this 6,000 hour gap was happening, in the past 30 years, so let's just say if this was the 1950s. This was the 1950s. I was rich and you were poor, right? We had the same upbringing. We played in the same soccer leagues. We went to the same scouts. We went to the same camps. But in the past 30 years, my family tripled down on the things that happened after school. So like I was more likely to go on summer camps, family vacations, trips to the zoo, trips to the museum, right? And that directly correlated with the widening income gap. And so while the politicians and the government, they're all slugging it out on policies, right? On like what you could do to, you know, increase wages, right? Like you have people like me that are figuring out how to change the mindset and develop young people to be the types of people that and build community and build the skills and the relationships so at an early age in order to transform that and transform their life. And so that's kind of like what led me to the idea of action sports, right? So like, you know, to go back to the story about like I love snowboarding, and I wanted to share with the kid that I was mentoring. Willie was his name. Willie was a kid. He was in foster care like all throughout his life. I honestly just wanted him to see that there was a bigger world out there. Mm-hmm. all he had known was New York City and the blocks that he lived in. That's all he knew. He didn't have a widening view of the world. He didn't really know how to interact with people that were different than him. He didn't really have the skills in order to like walk up to a store and ask for a job application. You know, like the little simple things. And so I saw that, like, what I learned from snowboarding was, you know, like every day I was learning something new. I was constantly evolving. I was growing as a person. Like, I was like, oh my God, I'm like, you know, I was in my mid 20s and I was like, oh my God, I'm still learning every day. Like every day that I went snowboarding, I was learning something about myself. I was becoming stronger, more determined. Because I knew that once I got past that hump, I would experience a sense of freedom, a sense of wonder and possibility. And that's what I wanted to happen in this in my mentee. And then over the course of, you know, the years of doing it, I actually realized we started to develop our own little theory on what action sports can do for a young person. And so all of this stuff that you see, right? This is stuff that, you know, if you grew up in a pretty functional home, right? Like you've gotten a little bit of this, right? You know, resilience, right? Like you are able to bounce back from obstacles, right? Like somebody, you get a job rejection, somebody, you know, dumps you in a relationship, you flunk a class, you know, any sort of setback, you have the skills in yourself in order to sort of overcome that. Self-reliant, you guys can show up. You can show up here, right? You can show up in life. And you have a community. You have a community of other people. Maybe you have a community at home. Maybe you go to church. Maybe you're, you know, something, whether you're into yoga or running, whatever, there's a community attached. And so I realized that there's a generation of young people that don't have any of this, and this is what I've learned in my work. And so action sports is amazing for that. Action sports is baked in, and I'll show you how. And so, like, from resilience become confident, right? From self-reliance becomes independence. And from community, you know how to operate in a community. You know how to, like, you know, like, because you're sitting at a table, you know the social cues, you know how to operate. And all of those little soft skills, that's what makes us successful, mm-hmm. right? You know what makes you successful is not necessarily what you know. It's those things between the lines. Mm-hmm. Success is the ability to be in an environment and know that you weren't really supposed to be there, but somehow you're there. And you fit in, right? Like, random. Like, you know, when you talk to somebody and they're like, oh, they mentioned some book. You're like, yeah, I read that book. And I read that author's other book too. Did you read that? You know what I'm talking about, right? Like, when you feel this sense of knowing, this sense of belonging, right? It gives you the confidence. You know that, like, maybe you may not have the skills, but you have two or three other skills that add up to a whole lot of confidence. Maybe you weren't even prepared to be in this program, but somehow you're fitting in, right? So I wanted to show you just a little bit about the action sports in youth development. This is like on a very hyper level, like what young people can get. And so this is, you know, resilience, self-reliance, and community. So, there's a guy named Forrest Edwards. Who skateboards in here? Does anybody skateboard? Okay. this is a skateboarder, Forrest Edwards, and he's doing a trick that's never been done at a spot called Wallenberg. It's just a beautiful thing to watch. Anyway. He gets back up. That's what action sports is. Almost. That's not good enough. That's totally not good enough.
He's gonna keep doing it. Do you see the sweat on his back? So, the best part about it is that all of that cheering, that group of people that are behind him, that's his community, and they're pushing him to land. Everybody wants to see him land. And the best part about what I love about action sports is that there's no competition, right? And I feel like it's almost like a utopia. It's like, I don't compete against you. If we're playing in our game together, if we're skateboarding or we're snowboarding or we're surfing all on the same day, depending on what you bring to the table, I will learn, right? And vice versa. And there's constant progression. And from a youth development perspective, like, I found that action sports was the best way to accelerate resilience, self-reliance, and community, right? So if you look at the traditional mentoring program, the traditional mentoring sort of paradigm was that you spend, and the Big Brothers is the traditional, is you spend 4 hours a month over the course of a year, and that's supposed to make a difference. And to me, the young people that I was working with, I was like, they don't have a year. They need to do this now. And so I wanted to find a way to drastically accelerate the things that they're supposed to get from a mentoring program. And to me, it was like, let's put them on a skateboard. Let's put them on a snowboard. Let's put them on a surfboard, you know? And so along with that just sort of came this whole sort of theory and notion around developing capital. So like from the skills, it's about human capital. From relationships, it's about social capital. And from experiences, we call it enrichment, but I actually call it right now cultural capital. So we have human, social, and cultural capital. And that's what you need in order to to close the opportunity gap. And so like, if you get those capitals with the foundation of being more resilient, more self-reliant, and more community-minded, then you can actually become a success. So the organization that I build this around is, it's called STOTE. We have core values. It stands for success, teamwork, openness, kudos, energy, and determination. It's sort of baked into the organization. You know, we strive to create, you know, from our board meetings to our programs, to the food that we eat, to the events that we do, it's all sort of our core values are baked in. And our mission is to promote personal development, academic achievement, and healthy living using action sports. The kids that we work with tend to be, you know, 70% are free lunch. We just, that actually changed because we expanded to the Bronx and it's probably closer to 90%. And so our kids are, you know, low income students. A lot of them come from single parent households. We have a lot of our students English language learners this year. So kids that have been in the country for less than 4 years, which makes me really excited because immigrants to this country, they are at the sort of tail end of opportunity here. They get stuck and that's where they are. And so a child of immigrants, I just want to create as much opportunity for them. And then high percentage are Black, Hispanic, Asian. Our main program is called Stoke for Success. And what we do is, we do after school and career exploration. We use action sports mentoring and we do community service. And so the program model, if you look at the problem, is that you have kids with right here, the bottom end, the gap, there's like 18 million kids need a mentor. There's, you know, lack of enrichment and there's high youth unemployment rate. And so like, even if you are a young, so like middle class kids, a lot of their sort of upbringing and a lot of their career life success comes from those early career experiences. So like, you know, they use their relationships and connections to be able to get internships and jobs, and they have jobs during the summer. But kids from from low-income backgrounds, they don't get the chance to do those sorts of things. And even when they're in college, they have to get a job, let's just say, working in a cafeteria to make ends meet, whereas high-income kids get to get unpaid internships because they get, you know, they have the chance to be a little bit more freer in their career choices, right? And so for me, the solution is I pack the skills, the relationships, and the experiences early on in high school. I don't wait for them to go into college to get those things. And then they can actually differentiate themselves so that when they sit down with the person that's about to give them an opportunity, they know what an opportunity looks like. They know how to, we have this thing, it's actually called, it's called FIES, F-I-E-S. Every single student knows it. It's firm handshake, introduce yourself, eye contact, and smile. On the very basic level, that's what we teach kids. On the very basic level, right? And then you have kids that are, that are able to see, because they're, when you're snowboarding, skateboarding, and surfing, like this kid, and I'm gonna play a little, I think I'm gonna play a video of him, but like, he knows 40 successful adults. That kid, 40 successful adults. He's experienced success in his life in our after school program. So what we do is we kind of take the long game. So if we know that there is an opportunity to close the opportunity, if there's a chance to close the opportunity gap, it's during using a cohort base, and you guys are in a cohort, right?
Yeah.
Right? Using a cohort base over a long period of time, and it's over the course of 4 years of high school. So we use project-based learning, so kids build skateboards after school. That's what they do. They build skateboards after school. In their second year, they make their own skateboard brand. In their third year, they learn career skills and they do career workshops. In the fourth year, they do an internship. Everything that we do is kind of passion-based, passion-filled. Because I started this and I love what I do, and I connect to what I'm. I realize that like success comes from having a career in which you are constantly nurtured and fulfilled, and like you're excited to go to work, and I feel like we'd have happier existence if everybody loved what they did, right? Even a garbage man or a janitor, if they felt more pride in their work, if they felt like if they had career potential, if they had a community around them, like anybody is successful, right? And so that's kind of what we teach. And so the types of industries, you know, we surround ourselves are like are the creative industries, to be honest. Those are the ones that are really attracted to action sports. So like advertising, media, technology, you know, architecture, like our kids are very into like photography, illustration. Those are the things that our kids are like naturally attracted to. So the after school program, what we do is we hire coaches. So these are young professionals to work in schools. So we train them and we give them professional development and support throughout the year. And so they work in schools. So we're in 15 schools between New York and LA. We on the weekends, so the after school program is two times a week after during the course of a year. And then on the weekends, so that woman standing up, she's actually like a marketing executive, so she loves the board. And so she mentors kids. We put everybody on the bus and we take them snowboarding. We provide everything from head to toe. So everything that you see on those kids, that's that. And every sport has a different set of life skills that the kids learn. So snowboarding is all about goal setting. So on the bus up to the mountain, kids actually learn how to set goals. It's like, in 5 years, I want to do this. It's like, I don't know what I want to do in 5 years. Well, just imagine what life could be like for you in 5 years, you know? And then while they're doing that, the mentor is doing their goals for 5 years. And then we convene in a circle. We start the beginning and the end of the day with a circle. And there's always a topic or a theme for the day. Surfing is probably the closest thing to religion in our program. It's so spiritual, not even meaning to be, but it's like, it's just something about the water. It's just kind of amazing. And so surfing is all about respect, trust, understanding of themselves and the environment. We clean up the beach right before we go surfing. We call it paying for waves because surfing is for waves. You
Avery Leap somehow. And our skateboarding program is really about communication skills, networking skills, and positive social habits. Here's an interesting thing. So we found that like snowboarding, skateboarding, surfing, and the after school program wasn't enough for our kids, right? They were like, we want more. So I'd come up with this idea of doing like a community service program. It's like not a big deal. I actually came up with doing a community service / action sports program in 2006. So we're in our 10th year. In the 9th year, and a year later after, I was like, oh, I kind of want to do this idea. And I had to put it on hold for about 4 or 5 years. But by listening to our kids, by listening, it's like, you know, our kids want to do more things. By listening to the communities that you're serving and by observing, they'll actually tell you how to design it. So if we listen to our kids, like I'm not even with the kids all the time, but I observe everything. And I don't run programs anymore, but I watch the kids. I watch data. I look at like the attendance. I listen to what kids are saying. I look at the dynamics within the groups. And our kids were telling us, like, they want more opportunities on the week. They want to feel more connected to their community. So we started a community service program, which is great. And so now kids are able to use the community service hours to apply towards high school graduation, like, which is kind of a coup, right? Because, and the best part about it is that all of our kids are using STOKE as a resume builder. They're using all their projects in all of the 4 years as something to talk about. And so these are our results. 100% on the youth development side, kids feel safe. Remember, safety is an indicator of trust. Mm. Trust is an indicator of social capital, right? And I like to say 100% of our kids feel safe in an action sports program. They feel more connected to school, they're more persistent, they feel more connected to community. Our kids are great presenters. They can stand in front of you and talk to you. They're better at collaborating, they're better at time management, and they're actually just more confident. This is our impact since we started. 3,500 kids since we started. We have 100% high school graduation rate, which I'm very proud of.
Wow.
We provide, wow. So like there's 990 something hours of hours that kids are in school. We provide an additional 41%, which is nuts. But think about it. You guys did a lot of stuff on the weekends.
Mm.
And that's what we're doing. And so a couple years ago, when we started to count those hours, we started looking at like, all right, how can we truly close that gap? And so like a couple years ago, it was like 300 hours. Last year was 444 hours. This year, every kid gets access to about 700 hours of time for STOKE. We still have a long way to get to that 6,000 hours, remember? Mm-hmm. And that's the next game. And so, we've been around for 10 years and I just kind of came up with it, you know, through the course of the past year of a way to grow and scale that will enable us, and I'm saying this on to 25,000 kids in the next 5 years. So
wow.
I'll come back next year.
Yeah, that's right.
So I wanna play this video of that kid. His name is Tamir, he's an awesome kid. He's amazing. But I've known him for 4 years and he'll just tell you, this is like almost like a day in the life of a kid in STOKE.
1, 2, 3, 4!
My name is Tamir Johnson. I've been with STOKE for 2 years. We surf every Saturday and we skate during Fridays, and it's like really cool. We go down to Paul Rockaway's to Beach 67 and we just hang down there and start surfing. The board I'm riding right now is a handmade board I made from STOKE in my first year at STOKE. It took a few months to make because I actually really a whole bunch of time, dedication into making it. So I took 7 layers of wood, long grain and coarse grain wood, so like you can see it's cut differently. And like I glued the wood in a certain pattern to actually get like the perfect flexibility and durability into the board. And did the whole thing by hand. I scraped it, then I sanded it by hand. It was very time consuming. But actually teach you something about like dedication, like staying involved in something that you start. I got involved in Stoke in my school. I was coming to a new high school, City Polytech, and they started telling us what Stoke was, all things about Stoke. This seemed like very interesting to me. It was like a brand new skateboard thing. You skateboard, surf, and you can snowboard. Right now, it's something that Stoke calls painful waves, where we go around and we clean up the beach. So when the beach is like really dirty, we just walk around, pick up the garbage, then we start surfing after that. With the 2 years I've been with Stoke, Stoke did like a lot for me. They like took me to the Catskills Mountain in upstate New York. And they taught me how to snowboard. I did not know nothing about snowboarding. Then they also taught me how to surf, about what I'm doing now, to improve my skateboarding skills way better. They also taught me two things called teamwork and determination, two of their core values, and helped me like actually say, okay, I fell. Okay, even though this kind of hurts, even though I'm falling a lot and it hurts, I'm just gonna get back up. I'm gonna try again, I'm gonna keep on falling, but I don't care, I'm just gonna keep on trying. I would recommend Stoke to some of my friends. I already did. So like some of them like really want Stoke out of their school. They really like the stories I tell. They really like coming out with me to like Stoke events. Like they actually thought about coming to my school so they can actually have Stoke and be with Stoke and actually have something more to do on their weekends than just play video games and hang out. Stoke is a really, really good program because it's like teaches kids more confidence, self-esteem, energy, determination, more teamwork, how to be more successful in life. Stoke gave me a whole bunch of different opportunities that I was not able to do by myself and my community. They took me out of my comfort zone. They actually made me like more of who I am today. I would say thank you for Steve for making the program, and thank you to for allowing Stoke to be in my school and actually letting me be out here and introducing me to all these new things. I would never imagine myself coming down to Far Rockaway and just taking a surfboard, coming out in the water and just like surfing. It's like, that's something really different and life changing.
So, how we like fund the organization is we do major events, and we have events and grants and corporations and so a bunch of various sort of models. It's not really fun to talk about, but I could talk more about it in the questions and answers. But what we do is do a lot of communities outward facing events. And so the one event that we do is called the Stoke Awards, where we honor various people that give back to through action sports. And so we've honored people like Tony Hawk and Paul Rodriguez. And, we've done art auctions, and I could tell you more about it, but during the question and answer, just sort of the new and different which I'm raising money. We have supporters like Paul Rodriguez. He's a pro skateboarder. Corey Bryant, actress, Travis Rice, pro snowboarder. These are some of our corporate sponsors. I think you can name as a couple. These are some of the people that give us in-kind product. We rely on a lot of in-kind, which is kind of crazy. But so in order to do our program, depending on the sort of model, is that we own all of the equipment. We actually have property, so we have a barn at the mountain which stores all of the gear. because one of the barriers to doing action sports are, you know, access to the transportation and the gear.
Mm-hmm.
And in the past, we used to, like, if you have kids that are like from the Bronx, you can't have them come to the city to get outfitted and then get on the bus, right? And so, you know, what we did is we have some generous donors that, like, bought a bus. So we have a barn and it's full of, like, you know, a lot of equipment. At the beach, where, I don't know if you saw that in the video, we have a, we call it, so there's a surf barn and we have a surf shack. We have a surf shack at the beach. It's full of our surfboards. And then we run our programs after school at the schools, and on the weekends they sort of come to the community. We even have, you know, owners that sort of, somebody give us a Prius so that we can, like, shuttle around all of our stuff, you know, and so, so yeah, and so we've been able to, you know, have some press, so we've been in a couple of places, and so I wanted to just tell you a little bit about, like, some of the, I read a lot, and I read voraciously, I read a ton of books, although I'm, I kind of, so the book that truly inspired me is, and I would highly recommend it, it's called, a book called No More Prisons. Does anybody read that book? Did you ever read that book?
No, but we have a juvenile justice big event in April.
Oh, okay.
I was going to invite you to.
Oh, yeah, yeah, I'd love to come. Yeah, so the guy, so this guy, he's, I, how I, the person that introduced me to mentoring was this guy who wrote the book, the first book on No More Prisons. I saw him on the G train, like, 11 years ago, and I followed him from car to car, and I, and I was actually more astounded. Because remember I was saying, like, do things that are a little uncomfortable?
Mm.
Like, I was actually amazed that a guy would self-publish his own book and sell it hand-to-hand on the subway. I was actually really curious. I was like, that takes a lot of courage. That takes a lot of balls to do something like that, right? Like,
mm-hmm.
And I wanted to just meet somebody that would do something like that. And I ended up buying his book. And it introduced me to the idea of mentoring. And then 10 years later, I started my own mentoring. Or, you know what I mean? Like, it's interesting to see. And then if you actually read the back of the book, it's kind of like the who's who of hip hop and popular culture. He was friends. And it's a really inspiring book, I think, for any
Can you get it
maker.
On Amazon?
Yeah, you can get it on Amazon, yeah, it's cheap. Another book that I highly recommend is a book called Think and Grow Rich. The guy named Napoleon Hill, he's like the granddaddy of, like, personal achievement and goal setting. He's like Tony Robbins, that's like his, like, came from him, right? And regardless of how you feel about anything hokey like that, like, in order to make big change in the world, you have to set goals and you need to go after them,
mm-hmm.
like, no abandon. And I remember, so this is like my 10-year anniversary, I was like after my first year, so like 2006, so like February 6, 2006, I was like broke. I was living in Far Rockaway because I was living in a city. My friend had loaned me his cat, like his futon, because he was like helping get his first job in the city. So I like felt like a little like I need to help this guy out, right? And so I remember I was like, I knew how to throw parties. And at the very least, that's a skill that everybody should have. Know how to throw a party. So I knew how to throw a party. And so I convinced this nightclub to give me their nightclub for free. And I marketed the hell out of this party. And I was selling tickets, and I had teams of people selling tickets and selling to their corporations. And then because I had a lot of connections with artists, I did like an art auction. I was like, oh, but this is a nightclub. Where can we do it? And so she was like, maybe you could do it here. And it was like the trash hallway of a nightclub, right? Where they throw the trash out at night. We swept it, went to Home Depot, cleaned the crap out of it. Like, I remember cleaning the crap out of this garbage hallway. We went to Home Depot, spent $100 on light fixtures, and hammer and nail and all that sort of stuff. We got all this art donated. And at the time, like, literally, my phone was, I was that, I was relying on people to help me with food. Like, people like, Steve, did you eat?
let me buy you dinner. And I'm like, all right, cool. So, and like, I had a lot of people, like all these little guardian angels that just kind of helped me out. And yeah, we ended up raising like $36,000, something like that, right? Which is crazy because then I was able to actually work on Stoked full time. I had like four jobs, like little jobs that were $100, you get $200. I was like, whatever, anyway, but it was really interesting to see that when you cast a big vision into the world, everybody wants to see you succeed. And oftentimes, whenever we have ideas, we hold on to them because we're fearful that somebody's going to take it or somebody's not going to support it. First of all, nobody wants your idea. You're not Mark Zuckerberg. You don't have Facebook. Right? Like, nobody wants your idea. But if you have the courage to actually go out and do it, you'll be surprised. It will be the most random stranger that will help you. And that's been like my life for the past 10 years. Like, you never know where you're gonna end up by taking a chance and doing something very, very, very uncomfortable. So all of these books, Power of Now is awesome. Mm-hmm. That helped me actually see colors clearer. It's a great book, right? Mm-hmm. There's a book called Tim Sanders, The Red Book, is Love is the Killer App. It's a great primer to building networks and connections. And it's, you know, basically three things: read everything, share everything, and connect with everyone. That's the thesis I need to buy. Anyway, Lean Startup is a great one because if you have an idea, it gives you a great framework for making it happen. That's it. So, lessons. Focus on a problem you're solving. Write down your idea on one sheet. Share with people your ideas. Sorry. Surround yourself with believers, find a mentor and learn more, set a big goal and obsess over it. So this is a very funny thing. I had a big goal and I was like, I need to raise $40,000. And you know what I did? I changed all of my passwords to raise $40,000. I took posters, raise $40,000. Like, I was obsessive about this stupid number. My pilot idea was to start this snowboard mentoring program. I was like, I thought I needed $4,000. You never need as much as you actually think, right? And I didn't raise the $40,000 to do the snowboard program, but I ended up doing the snowboard program. I ended up doing a skateboard program. I ended up doing a surfing program. And I ended up doing another skateboard program in the fall, right? And my original goal in my pilot was to work with 40 kids. I ended up working on all of those programs with 40 kids, and I ended up raising $39,998. No lie. I wouldn't say, I don't have anything to prove. Like, I'm not lying. That's how much I appreciate.
Okay,
I'm not selling you any. This isn't an infomercial. I'm just telling you. Set a goal and obsess over it, and then make it happen. And tell everybody that's what you want to do. And the last one: take care of yourself. Get enough sleep. Don't party too hard. Party just enough, but not too hard. You know? Like, seriously, take care of yourself, because I'm speaking from experience. Like, if you don't take care of yourself. The thing, and I should actually add one more thing, is once you start something, you kind of have to finish it. Because once you kind of show people that you can do something, it's kind of like your card. But that one instance in which you touch and you impact a community, you have an obligation to keep that going. If it doesn't work, then you can end it. But if it's working and you're not that into it, but you're still impacting people, you need to have a responsibility to make sure that it's sustainable. All right. So that's my info.
All the way.
Yeah, that's it.